everybody, and welcome inside the Rogers studio here for another segment of Attack Wrap. I'm your host, Matt Sanderson. A little bit of a different Attack Wrap this time around, seeing as I am doing this show solo. John Morris is off for the night, and the Owen Sound Attack, well, they're on the road for a early morning game in Hamilton tomorrow, so I'm going to be giving you a lot of highlights and interviews and whatnot throughout this week, and we'll talk a little bit about what's going on around the OHL. Quickly want to give you the trivia question. We have two for tonight. The first one is for a pair of tickets to February the 8th game with the Flint Firebirds, February the 15th. And the second one will be February the 18th with the Oshawa Generals. So, first trivia question for you. Name the attack player who won the Red Lecky Award for largest contribution to the organization last year. So remember, these questions may not be somebody from the team this year, so you're going to have to freshen up on your attack knowledge. But make sure that you call in, give us the right answer, and you'll win those tickets. Now we'll check what's going on around the OHL. Let's start off with the Pioneer Energy Player of the Week. And this is a guy that we've seen many times before already this season, Alex DeBrincat from the Erie Otters. You see his stats there, 44 goals, 48 assists, 92 points. He's got 6 goals and 11 points in his last 3 games, averaging a plus 1. And Chicago Blackhawks draft prospect there. But he leads the league in points throughout the OHL. And Alex DeBrincat, we've seen what he can do on the ice when he's played with the Owen Sound Attack. But this is a big reason why the Erie Otters are doing so well as they are this season. He also has become the Otters' all-time leading goal scorer. And that came on Thursday night when they won 5-4 over the Peterborough Petes. So, Alex DeBrincat, the funny thing about that is he's only played 171 games in the OHL. And he's already the Erie Otters' all-time leading scorer. So, that's pretty exciting for him. Now, we'll go back home a little bit with the Huron Tractor Player of the Week. And this is a gentleman that is the captain of the Owen Sound Attack, Santino Santorami. And for the attack captain, 3 goals, 44 assists, 47 points this season, 2 goals, 20 points in his last 11 games, and the attack went 10-0-0-1 with him and his contributions. Yes, only 3 goals, but 44 assists on the season. That's pretty impressive for the attack captain. But we do have a caller on the line with us. Brock is on the line. Brock, how are you tonight? Hello, Brock. Hi, Brock. Sorry, I'm getting a little bit of static here. Can you hear me?
Not a problem. How are you?
Good, Brock. Good. Do you have the answer to our trivia question?
Yeah, the answer is 1/3 of the Backstreet Boy line, Jacob Bush.
Jacob Bush. Well played. I like that analogy. Jacob Bush is the answer. So congratulations, Brock. You're going to win 2 tickets to the Flint Firebirds game on February the 15th. While you're on the line, do you have any questions for us?
No, I don't.
No? Okay. Well, congratulations, Brock. Stay on the line so we can grab your information.
Perfect.
So, already early on in the show, somebody's grab those tickets. I'll throw out the second trivia question for you. Name the attack player who won the Unsung Hero Award for the 2015-2016 season. Remember, these are for 2 tickets for the Oshawa Generals game on February the 18th. So make sure that you dive in, get the proper information on this one. Should be a no-brainer for those hardcore attack fans. Make sure that you call in, though. Getting back to everything, we're going to take a quick look at the I believe it's going to be the OHL Top Performers of the Month. And Santino Santarami is in this one as well as the OHL Defenseman of the Month. And you see it there. We've already talked about his stats and what he's already done. But the crazy thing is the way that he has stepped up for this Attack team all season long. And he actually at one point had 30 assists or 32 assists on the season without even scoring a goal. Now he's scored a goal in his last few weeks. So Santino Santarami, doesn't matter about the goal scoring for him, it's all about the assists, and he's a big reason why this Owen Sound Attack team is in the position that they are now. OHL Player of the Month is going to be Adam Mascarin from the Kitchener Rangers, and we've seen him multiple times at the Bayshore, and understandably why. 5 goals, 22 points in 12 games, points in 11 of his last 12 games, and he's third in OHL scoring, 31 goals, 49 assists, 80 points on the season. At one point in time, he was the OHL scoring leader. That's now not the case anymore, as Alex DeBrincat has taken over that title, but he's definitely a big reason why this Kitchener Rangers team is in the position that they're in right now. Going with OHL Rookie of the Month from the Oshawa Generals, Alan McShane, the first year forward, played for the Erie Otters early on. But you see it there, 7 goals, 12 points in 12 games, second in rookie scoring, and 13 goals, 20 assists, 33 points. This was a great pickup for the Erie Otters as he's a Collingwood native. First round pick in 2016. He is going to be a special player for the Oshawa Generals. So that was a huge pickup by them. Only have about a minute left. We're going to quickly show you the Eastern Conference standings, and we'll take a look at the Western Conference standings as well. The Oshawa Generals sitting up in top spot there, 30-15, 3-2, 65 points. 10 points back to Mississauga Steelheads, a team who has definitely come on as late, and the Peterborough Petes as well. And now we'll take a look at the Western Conference. The Erie Otters, 77 points. They're slowly starting to make up ground and run away from the pack, if you'd like to say. 37-10-2-1. Sioux Greyhounds there as well. London Knights, Windsor Spitfires, Owen Sound Attack. But stick around, we have plenty more coming your way here on Attack Wrap. Welcome back, everybody, inside the Rogers studio for tonight's edition of Attack Wrap. Matt Sanderson, and as I said off the top of the show, I am doing this one solo tonight, so we're going to have a lot of OHL scoring and highlights of the Owen Sound Attack games and interviews and rapid fires throughout this segment, so make sure that you stick around with us because we have plenty more coming your way. We're going to kick it off with the OHL scoring, and if we can grab that up there in a minute, we've already talked about a gentleman who has won Pioneer Energy Player of the Week and the CHL Player of the Week too. Alex DeBrincat from the Erie Otters, 92 points already, and Taylor Radish, he's got 31, 51 assists, 82 points on the season for him. He's 10 points back of his teammate. I don't think he has many complaints when he's playing with Alex DeBrincat, though. For the Owen Sound Attack scoring, and we've talked about this race, if you'd like to call it, for top scoring for the Owen Sound Attack. Well, Patrice Palmu, 29 goals, 31 assists, and 60 points. And you see the top four there all in almost 50-point range or higher. But we do have a caller on the line with us. We'll jump back to the stats in a moment. Matt is on the phone. Matt, you're talking to Matt. How are you?
Good, yourself?
Good. So I hear that you may have the answer to the trivia question.
I'm a little rough on the pronunciation of the last name, but I believe it's Bryson Cianfrone, something like that.
Yes, Bryson Cianfrone, you're correct.
Cianfrone?
Yeah.
Okay. I'll remember that one.
All right, so congratulations, Matt. You won two tickets to the Oshawa Generals game on February the 18th.
That's awesome. Thank you very much.
Not a problem. While you're on the line, do you have any questions for me?
No, not exactly. You're doing a great job. I just want to say go attack on this upcoming road trip that they're going to be on.
Absolutely. Well, thanks a lot, Matt, and stay on the line so we can grab your information.
Thank you very much, sir.
So now all of the already early on in the show, we have those pairs of tickets away sent off to their respective winners. But if you do have any questions or whatnot, make sure you can tweet me at MattSanderson32 throughout tonight's show, or you can even feel free to call in. And if you have any thoughts or questions on this season, feel free to bounce them off me. Getting back to what's going on in the OHL. OHL goaltending, we're going to grab the stat here in just a moment. And Michael McNiven, we've talked about all season long how well he's played, and he's 27-8-1-1, sitting in third place right now, .916 save percentage, .228 goals against average. But Michael DiPietro of the Windsor Spitfires, somebody who McNiven's been battling back and forth with all season in that top spot, and then Tyler Parsons of the London Knights, rightfully so up there. He's been huge for the Knights over the past few weeks. Seems like that motivation of him winning the gold medal game in the World Juniors has really put him over the top this season. We'll quickly take a look at the Academic Players of the Month. This is always a good thing to see too, because not only do you see what these attack players or these OHL players do on the ice, but you see what they do off the ice as well. In the East Division, we've got William Ennis from the Oshawa Generals. Midwest Division, Luke Richardson from the Kitchener Rangers. Central Division, Ben Jones from the Niagara Ice Dogs. And West Division, Ryan McGregor from Sarnia. So congratulations to those gentlemen of getting the top academics for this month. Now we're going to go into our highlights. The first highlight pack we're going to show you is the Owen Sound Attack versus the London Knights.
Bourque propels it out through the line, racing down the wing. Here's a Gadrovec, and now Jones is hauled down. The goal! Shoots! Scores! And behind the knee. What now? It was Matlin, off the glass for Carbonaire, in and out. Look at these moves, and Philip Oak checks him. At the last second, McDonald scores! Number two! Play of this evening's contest, they're up by a couple. Back to the line. Here's the Knights, Van de Zappel, Klippu in front of the net, a pinball's off escape. Now they score! Pickenage, the captain, 3-0. Dudas back to the line again. Check, that was Suzuki. Ball move, shot, rebound. Hancock couldn't stuff it home. Now Roberts will sail it in deep. Crawley after it. Now here's a chance for Owen Sound. Price and the shot right on. Takes a peek for Salaturo. The right-hand shot. Last pass was intended a little behind him because he is a right-hand shot. There's a quick shot. Home she goes. Stevens, 4-0.
Definitely probably a game that the Owen Sound Attack would like to have back, but they did grab some redemption the next night as they took on the Windsor Spitfires. Let's take a look at that highlight pack.
Good evening, everybody, and welcome inside the Harry Lumley Bayshore Community Center for Brandon Vandershot Owen Sound Attack Hockey on Rogers TV.
Christy and the Leader family have been instrumental in helping support Heartbeats and Hockey Sticks and the Owen Sound Cardiac Rehabilitation Program over the last 2 years. Because of Christy and her father, Bert, and the entire Leader family, and our community partners, we're able to give back to those like Keith Davidson, who needed the services that the cardiac rehab program provided. Just before Christmas of 2015, Keith, who's easily recognizable as one of the Attack's biggest fans, suffered a cardiac event that required a stent into his heart. After spending time at St. Mary's Hospital at Kitchener, Keith was referred to the Owen Sound Cardiac Rehab Program, where he received lifestyle coaching, physical training, and all the support to return to greater health than prior to his treatment. Keith credits the program for helping him become healthier than he's ever been, and with the help of the funds raised here tonight, people of Gray and Bruce have access to life-changing and life-saving programs. Thank you to all of you.
Starting in net for the Windsor Spitfires will be Michael DiPietro, his third start in three nights. He stopped 53 of 55 shots in the two games coming into tonight. The third, he's first in the league in GA and first in the league in shutouts, Mark, now with six. And in net for the Owen Sound Attack is Michael McNiven. And Matt talked about it off the top. He's been in a bit of a tough stretch, 15 goals allowed over his last three games. The 11 games prior to that, 15 goals allowed. So let's get back on track, and there should be lots of motivation for him tonight.
Chance to check out these two clubs and the numbers they have produced throughout this season.
And the big one that's going to jump out at everyone is the goals against, and the two teams in the league that have allowed the least goals against, and it's a race now that we've been looking at for probably a month of which team's going to finish with the least goals against. Owen Sound has it right now, but they played two less games.
Another will dump it in. McNiven out of the goal, tries to slow it down. Behind the goal, wraparound attempt, and they score. Velarde on the wraparound gets it past McNiven, and Windsor strikes first.
A real good job by Gabe Velarde to get in on this loose puck. And you know, at first look, it didn't look like he was going to be able to get to that post before McNiven, but the long reach of the centerman, and he just tucks it in just before McNiven can close that gap. We'll look at it here on the forecheck on Bourque is what starts it. DG Jacinto's in there, Velarde's in there, and real nice play.
19th of the season for Gabe Velarde as he gets involved early, has his Windsor Spitfires out in front. Owen Sound quickly trying to reply. There's a shot, and they score! Suzuki gets it right back. And the top prospects are firing here tonight. It's tied 1-1.
Velarde gets his 19th, Suzuki his 24th of the season. And me, Mark, it was almost weird watching Gabe Velarde score because we haven't seen teams come in here and score the first goal against Owen Sound very many times. And if you're going to let it happen, this is the way to respond. Ryan McGill goes back with his first line. A nice pass by Jonah Gadjevich. And just a gorgeous shot by Nick Suzuki. A great angle of it there by our crew.
But tonight I'm focusing on three Windsor Spitfires that are off the ice and not playing. Jeremiah Addison, Logan Brown, and Logan Stanley, due to injury, are not in the lineup. These three have been huge for the Windsor Spitfires squad. Stanley has had knee surgery. Best case scenario, he's probably back closer towards the Memorial Cup. Jeremiah Addison has a bruised lung and has been out for eight games. Logan Brown is out with a hand injury and could be back late February. Brown and Addison are dynamic forwards to help this squad, and Logan Stanley is an intimidating force on defense.
Tonight's matchup, pretty big one between the Netminders as you get a look at the numbers right there. And focusing in on Michael McNiven's numbers, you talked about giving up, I guess you could say, 14 goals, as one of those 15 in the last three was a shootout goal, but his numbers have been outstanding all year. They jump up a little bit when it comes to save percentage. He banks it off the boards. Boca after it. King watched it come through, and the puck is loose. Lashram finds it, takes the shot, and it was blocked. Hammers it, but it's held in by Phillips. Over to Durzi. Durzi, redirection, and a blocker save by DiPietro. But to DG Jacinto. Lost in his skates for a brief moment. Stolen now by Zapula. Zapula drops. Campbell snaps, and a blocker save by DiPietro.
Gabe, you scored a goal to jump out there, and then they ended up tying it up. But what are you feeling out there on the ice with aggressiveness from the Attack?
Yeah, for sure. I think obviously their aggressive forecheck is right for this this rink. Obviously, it's a smaller rink, so it's tough. And I think we just gotta get better in our own zone. I think just getting pucks out and making the right plays, and myself included, and all the guys here. We just gotta chip pucks out and do the right things in our own zone, and then offense will come off that.
It started with a goal at 7:20 by Gabe Velarde, 20th of the year for the top prospect for the upcoming NHL entry draft. They've changed that now to an unassisted goal, so Di Giacinto does not get an assist. It's unassisted at 7:20, and if you looked away for 17 seconds, you missed a goal because Nick Suzuki quickly replied. Santino Santorami and Jonah Gajewicz picking up the helpers there on Suzuki's 24th of the year. Suzuki hasn't really had a whole lot to show for on the score sheet in the last few games, but he gets a big goal there at a key moment to get his team back on even terms. And the shots on goal right there, 23-4. And he'll spin back behind his own goal and pass it over to Chatfield. So Windsor, 3-for-3 on the PK, which now runs their streak to 45 in a row. Out in front now, there's a shot. What a scores! Gajewicz looked like DiPietro was going to make an unreal save there. He got a piece, but not enough. And the Spitfires get a little sloppy in their own zone, and the Attack are able to pounce on a big opportunity. The circle down low, one timer saved by McNiven as he denies not in the slot. Day has it again, down low for Bracco. He's in the corner, back up to Day. He's gonna let the shot go, and a glove save made by Michael McNiven. As you said, John, it's an unsportsmanlike penalty to Tyler Nuther. And the Attack go to work on the Windmar power play. Hancock scores. Kevin Hancock fires it top corner, and the Attack lead 3-1.
Well, Nuther made it quick, but that's a long skate across the ice after a penalty like that. One that he probably feels he didn't deserve. And this is a shot we've seen from Kevin Hancock now a few times, and seems to be a more common thing, especially when the pass is coming from Cordell James and he just rips it upstairs.
Cole, give us a little bit of a rundown of that second period. What adjustments did you guys make being able to come out and have a good second?
I think we stuck to our game plan, and we were consistent with what we were doing in the first, and picked it up a little bit. We got to stay out of the box because you know, they've got a really good power play, and putting ourselves in a bad position there. But I think if we stay disciplined and we keep it simple and keep putting pucks on net and working hard, then good things are going to happen.
Let's look at the scoring summary from period number two, and it was the Attack who got on the board early, just 38 seconds in. Jonah Gajewicz, his 28th of the season. Unfortunately, Jonah, we believe, got a puck in the face when he was sitting on the bench. He's left. Don't see him on the bench here to start the third. Kevin Hancock made it 3-1 with a power play goal to snap the Spitfires' PK streak. 23rd of the year for Hancock, 8th on the power play from James and Palmu, and you see the shots on goal. Very even in period number two, but still a sizable lead way through the neutral zone. Comes right into the Owen Sound end, and King took the puck away, but there's a wraparound by Di Giacinto, and McNiven made the save. And here goes Nick Suzuki looking for the breakaway. Suzuki up against Chatfield with the shot, and it was stopped by DiPietro. By Campbell, allows the Attack to change as Day tries to split through two black jerseys. Lost the puck, Velarde finds it. Here's a shot, glove save by Michael McNiven. And once again, Di Giacinto comes in. McNiven gives him another poke. The penalties, 5-on-4 now, with DiPietro on the bench. So extra attacker out there for Windsor. Again. Puck comes out, high slot, Hancock's got to it. Suzuki's open up ice, Hancock finds him, and Nick Suzuki gets his second of the night, calmly placing it into the empty net, and the attacker up 4-1. Couple nice moves to go around Corcoran, looks in front for James, broken up. Luchuk will find it, and this is gonna do it. The Owen Sound Attack, after falling last night in London, bounce back on Heartbeats and a Hockey Sticks night here at the Bayshore with a big 4-1 win over the Windsor Spitfires. as Nick Suzuki leads the charge with two goals.
Tuesday night, I talked to Michael McDavid about last weekend's performances and about how big it was to get that win on Sunday, and he said, good teams don't lose two games in a row. And, you know, that's something that was maybe going through his head coming into tonight's game after the loss last night, and he was really good for the Owen Sound Attack and a big part of this 4-1 win.
And the Attack salute their fans here. A standing room only crowd tonight at the Bayshore. Watch their hometown squad come up with a big victory as the Attack pick up 2 points in the standings, which gives them now 68 on the year. And they sit only 3 points back of the Windsor Spitfires with two games in hand. So it'll be a good battle as the Attacks look to secure, track down, and secure a spot, a home ice spot in the playoffs. So 33 wins now this season for the Owen Sound Attack.
And as our play-by-play man, Mark McKelvey, reiterated there, that was a huge win for the Owen Sound Attack, winning 4-1 over the Spitfires after the 4-1 shutout loss to the London Knights the night before. Stick around, though. We have plenty more coming your way. We're going to go behind the scenes with a couple interviews, Markus Phillips, GM Dale DeGray, Nick Suzuki, Cordell James, and plenty more coming your way. Stick around. Got more. Welcome back, everybody, inside the Rogers studio for more of tonight's edition of Attack Wrap. But now we're going to step aside and we're going to go behind the scenes with Markus Phillips with a after-game interview.
All right, Mark McKelvey standing with Markus Phillips on the Sound Attack defenseman. Markus, a big 4-1 win for you guys tonight over the Windsor Spitfires. An important game after last night's loss. What did you feel the team did differently tonight to get the 2 points?
I think we followed the game plan to a T. Had a good effort there and a good bounce back from last night.
And in last night's game against London, it obviously maybe seemed like they just kind of, you guys were a step behind all night. But tonight, first period, 23 shots, but you only get one goal. Is there ever some frustration that sinks in, or do you know that, you know, it's going to come eventually?
I think it's going to come eventually. We just got to stick to the game plan and continue to play our game.
Now, last weekend you took part in the CHL Top Prospects game. A great experience, I'm sure, but you had to miss a couple games here in Owen Sound. How tough was that to be watching from afar?
Yeah, it was tough. I actually got to the hotel and watched the third period overtime and the shootout for the London game, and it was obviously hard watching that. Happy to be back and looking forward to it.
Now, touching on the weekend you had in Quebec City, they did some off-ice and on-ice testing on Sunday. Saw your name on the top of the leaderboard in some events. Talk about the testing they put you through, and did you feel you were well prepared for it?
Yeah, I've done all the testing before, so it was pretty straightforward. Lots of forward skating and transition stuff, so yeah, I was happy I did well.
And then on Monday night in the game, it was a bit of a high-scoring affair, but overall, how'd you feel you performed?
I thought I played well, mistake-free. It was hard to play in a game like that where guys are coming in from all different systems and whatnot, and we're not accustomed to playing with each other, but yeah, I thought I played well.
And you were playing against your teammate here, Nick Suzuki, yeah. And we all saw the picture on Twitter of you guys coming together, so you can be honest, does he hit hard, or and did you know it was coming?
Yeah, I saw him coming, and I tried to get out of the way, but yeah.
And overall on the weekend, Quebec City, were there any nerves? Did you feel any anxious moments knowing that this is such a big stage and that, you know, there's all 31, there'll be 31 teams at the draft in Chicago in June. There were 31 teams watching you?
Of course, yeah. During the testing, if you looked up from the ice, there was a whole sea of black pea coats and clipboards. So it was obviously nerve-wracking, but it's still the same game. You just got to work through that.
And does being at the Top Prospects game sort of get you even a little more excited? I'm sure you're anxious for June, but does that even just kind of fuel the juices a little more?
Of course it does, but I'm still trying to take one day at a time, and that time will come eventually.
All right, well, best luck the rest of the way.
All right, thank you.
Markus Phillips there with our play-by-play man, Mark McKelvey. And Markus is on the NHL scouting rankings. We have his numbers here. You see him there. He's ranked right now 62nd overall and 9 goals, 14 assists on the season for 23 points. But he's been a big staple in this Owen Sound Attack team. the big thing is you see the loss in what the Owen Sound Attack had missed out on while he was away, and Nick Suzuki for that matter. And Markus Phillips is just a dynamic player and a great defenseman for the Attack. But stepping aside, we'll switch gears here and we'll go with behind the scenes with GM Dale DeGray in rapid fire.
Dale, your earliest childhood hockey memories?
Probably playing church league hockey with my older brother.
Dale, players talk a lot about superstitions. As a GM, do you have any you go through before the games?
Before the games, no, but I have a very tough time watching games on TV when I'm at home.
Dale, if there was a tell about this team, a vibe that you got from them before the game that kind of gave away if they were going to have an on night or an off night?
I'm a big camaraderie sort of a guy. So if it's too quiet, I think we're usually in for a slow start and a tough night.
Dale, a moment in your hockey career that stands out to you?
Probably scoring my first goal against the New York Rangers, and just how that felt.
Is there a current player in the OHL that you look forward to getting a look at on any given night?
I've always been an Adam Mascarin fan. Mm-hmm. I always had a pretty good shot. I think he's got one of the best shots in the league. I don't want to see him get it against us, but I kind of enjoy watching him tee it up.
And maybe someone you've been in the OHL now for 10 years, who is maybe your favorite player you got to look at over that time?
I was a huge Jesse Blacker fan. I brought him in. I loved the way he played defense. I loved his carefree attitude, and he was a great teammate.
Dale, how is this team sized up so far through the first 45 games of the season compared to what your expectations were?
I'll be straight up and tell you that I thought we would be anywhere from fourth to sixth. Mm-hmm. We're right there. We've probably have more wins than I thought, but position-wise, it's really where I thought we might be.
Your favorite activity outside of the hockey rink?
Probably playing golf. I don't play it enough. I wish I could play it more.
Your expectations for the new U18 draft?
If we could get one of those four players or five players to sign a deal and play for us next year, it would make it all worth it.
Difference in the team from 2015-16 to 2016-17?
I think we're a little bit more mature, and the belief that they have in themselves to be able to win every game they play.
Thank you, Dale.
Mark McKelvey caught up with Nick Suzuki after Saturday's game. Let's take a look and see what Nick Suzuki had to say.
All right, Mark McKelvey with Nick Suzuki. Nick, you guys are coming off a 4-1 win tonight over the Windsor Spitfires. Before we get into talking about the top prospects game, overall, coming into tonight, you guys were coming off a loss last night in London. How important was this for a bounce-back win, not just for picking up the 2 points, but sort of for boosting the confidence around the team?
Yeah, definitely. We wanted to come in tonight and get the 2 points, and coming off a bad loss against London, we really wanted to come in, play hard, and definitely win the game.
All right, so you were at the top prospects game last weekend and had to miss a few games with your club team here in Owen Sound. How difficult was that to not be here to help out with the guys?
Yeah, it's definitely hard. I definitely wanted to be here, help the guys, and kind of continue the streak going, but I really had a lot of fun over in Quebec, and glad I went.
So I saw some of the numbers from the off-ice testing. You did pretty well in the on-ice testing. Talk about kind of the stuff they put you guys through, and how unique was that to, in the middle of the season, have to kind of get put through that kind of testing?
Yeah, it's definitely pretty unique. They had a lot of just skating drills. You got a broad jump, vertical jump, and a lot of kind of movement. So you got to really be prepared for that. And I've done a couple of them before, so I thought I was pretty prepared.
And now in the game on Monday night, you were going up against your teammate Markus Phillips, and I think we all saw the picture on Twitter of you giving him a good check there. Yeah. When you're out there playing, do you even realize that it's him?
Yeah, definitely.
Okay.
Yeah, I look up and it's him, so I definitely want to lay my check on him. So it was really cool trying to play against Markus in that game, and I think we had a lot of fun.
and it's a big stage. Obviously, the top prospects game is what any draft eligible player wants to have an opportunity to showcase their skills. Were there at all any nerves for you or anxious moments, or did you overall kind of take everything in stride?
Yeah, I think I was pretty nervous kind of coming in, but once I got there, I was just kind of relaxed and definitely just prepared for the game. And right before the game, it was kind of, you got the nervous butterflies going, but right when you get on the ice, it kind of goes away.
All right, well, best of luck next weekend with your three road games coming up.
Yeah, thank you.
We'll take a quick break, but we'll be back with plenty more here on Attack Wrap. Welcome back, everybody, inside the Rogers studio for more of tonight's edition of Attack Wrap. If you hadn't tuned in the first part of the show, we went over a little bit of the players of the week and players of the month. I'm going to go over those highlights again here for you. Pioneer Energy Player of the Week, along with CHL Player of the Week, is Alex DeBrincat from the Erie Otters. Rightfully so. He's been playing some phenomenal hockey this season. 44 goals, 48 assists, 92 points on the season. He's had 6 goals and 11 points in his last 3 games. And he's a Chicago Blackhawks prospect. Definitely, if you're a Blackhawks fan or part of the Blackhawks organization, you're looking at this kid and licking your chops with the diversity and the dynamic aspect that this kid can bring to the table in the game of hockey. So it's going to be exciting to see what he can do in the next couple of years. He also has, I believe he's, sorry, in 171 games has passed is the all-time leading scorer for the Erie Otters. In just 171 games, that's incredible. And he still has plenty more hockey left in him. And who knows how long he'll be in the OHL for. So there could be plenty more records for him to break. Now the Huron Tractor Player of the Week, Santino Santorami. Owen Sound Attack, captain, 2 points in 2 games. He's 3rd in OHL defensive scoring, 3 goals this season, but 44 assists. And that's the if you have a marker, you'd want to circle that stat as the one that pops out the most. 47 points this season. He's a plus 25 in the plus minus category in 49 games. 20 points in 11 games. And when the Attack went 10-0-0-1 with him playing the way that he is. Like I said, though, 44 assists for the Attack captain. He certainly has had his chances this season to score goals, and he has a couple to his name, but that's not the big aspect for him. The big thing for Santino Santorami is the way that he is able to set up his teammates, Kevin Hancock, Jonah Gadjevich, Petrusz, Paul Mu, Nick Suzuki. The list goes on and on. And because of his 44 assists, he's helped their season be even better, with those four being the four players that are either hovering on the 50 points mark this season or have surpassed it. So good on Santino Santorami. OHL Players of the Month. We talked about Santorami being the defensive player, but OHL Player of the Month, Adam Mascarin, 5 goals, 22 points in 12 games, points in 11 of his last 12, and he's 3rd in OHL scoring, 80 points. You look at that and you think, how is he only 3rd? And we've talked about Alex DeBrincat already, but 31 goals, 49 assists for the Kitchener Rangers. Rangers sitting in 6th place behind the Owen Sound Attack, 10 points back of Owen Sound, but Adam Mascarin is one of the big reasons why the Kitchener Rangers are where they are right now this season. And for the Rookie OHL Player of the Month, it is Alan McShane. He was the 2016 first-round pick for the Erie Otters, Collingwood native, 7 goals, 12 points in 12 games, and he's 2nd in rookie scoring, 13 goals, 20 assists, 33 points on the season. This was a big pickup. I know that Oshawa Generals fans had to give up Anthony Cirelli, but in return, they get this player in Alan McShane. I'm going to call it now. I think he's going to have a very, very profitable OHL career with the Oshawa Generals. Going to the Western Conference, we're going to take a quick look at those standings. We've talked about how well the Owen Sound Attack have played this season. You see the standings. We're going to try to break it down here for you a little bit. The Erie Otters with top spot, only 2 points back, of the London Knights, 37-10-2-1. Sault Ste. Marie Greyhounds right behind them with 73 points. London Knights with 75. Windsor, 32-12-5-2, 71 points. The Owen Sound Attack, 3 points behind them. But the big spot that you should look at there in the goal, in the games category, 2 games in hand the Owen Sound Attack have over the Windsor Spitfires. So not only are they on their heels, but they could very well surpass them. We'll have to see how that matchup pans out for the rest of the season. Kitchener Rangers, like we already talked about, 6th place, 58 points. Sarnia Sting, 56 points. And the Flint Firebirds, with what happened with them last season, it's great to see them back in the playoff picture here. 24-21-1-3 on the season for them in the 8th spot. Now for the Eastern Conference. The Oshawa Generals, they're running away with it right now. 65 points, 10 points separate them from the 2nd place team of the Mississauga Steelheads, who have been playing some great hockey as of late. The Peterborough Petes up there as well. And the Kingston Frontenacs are in 4th place. Hamilton, 23-22-3-2 for 51 points. And the Sudbury Wolves, Ottawa 67s, and the North Bay Battalion, that rounds out the 8 teams, but the Niagara Ice Dogs tied with the Battalion. That could be a dogfight, so to speak, for that final playoff spot there in the Eastern Conference. OHL goaltending. We'll go to OHL scoring first, and we already talked about Alex DeBrincat with how well he's played this season. 92 points. He leads the top 10 scoring. Taylor Radish right behind him. And you can go down the list. Patrice Palmu from the Owen Sound Attack sitting in that 10th spot. He's got 29 goals. That's a little bit of a misprint there. 29 goals, 31 assists for 16 points this season. So Patrice, definitely a defining factor of the Owen Sound Attack. But now, stepping away from all of the reviews of what's going on in the OHL, we'll go behind the scenes with Coach Ryan McGill.
Now with Owen Sound Attack head coach Ryan McGill. Ryan, you guys are coming off a 4-1 win tonight over the Windsor Spitfires. An important game as it pertains to the Western Conference standings, but especially important after losing one last night. What did you see different tonight from your team that you maybe didn't get last night?
Well, I thought we played a lot more urgent. I thought our penalty killing was excellent tonight. Our penalty killing hasn't been great the last 3 games. And it starts with your goalie. Our goalie gave us the saves he needed to make on the penalty kill, and the guys really were more urgent and desperate in that situation. And I thought that we were way more consistent sticking to the game plan than we have been last night, for sure.
That's now 20 wins on home ice this season for your squad. When it comes to home ice, is it maybe as simple as just getting the matchups you want that has led to this success?
Well, I mean, obviously matchups for us are important, but not so much forwards against forwards. But our matchups we like to create are the ones that are our forwards against their D. And then on top of that, we like to create some momentum through our shifts. So I think that on home ice, you certainly can create that, but we want to try to create that identity on the road at the same time, creating momentum. So hopefully that yesterday's game was just a blip on the radar.
You guys had 23 shots in the first period here tonight, but you only get one goal to show for it. Are you worried about frustration maybe sinking in a little bit?
No, we know how good their goaltending is across the way. We have to just stick with it and stay the course. And I thought our guys did a way better job of staying the course this time against him than maybe previous.
Now you have 3 road games coming up next week, including one that's a rare day game for a school day game. Do you have any concerns about staying focused because of the early time?
Well, obviously, we've got to make a little bit of an adjustment. We've got to get our ready clock, so to speak, up for an early game. We've got to make sure we have a good meal the night before. We make sure we get a lot more sleep than normally. Maybe guys have to go to bed maybe an hour earlier, and they got to be focused and sharp as soon as they get up. So we've got a couple things planned, hopefully, that gets our engines running fairly quickly in that game, because you know how loud those games can be with all those kids in the building.
All right, thank you very much. Good luck next week.
Thank you.
Great to hear from Coach Ryan McGill. Obviously pleased with the 4-1 win over the Windsor Spitfires on Saturday. Now we'll go back behind the scenes with Mark McKelvey while he interviews Trenton Bourque.
McKelvey standing here with Trent Bourque. Trent, you guys are coming off a 4-1 win tonight over the Windsor Spitfires. Big game considering you guys dropped one last night in London, and points are big right now in the Western Conference standings. How much attention to detail was needed to get the 2 points here?
Yeah, no, it was huge. The detail in the game plan was provided for us before the game and what we need to do to be able to get the 2 points. And that's all we had to follow that in order to get the 2 points. So it's definitely a big part of our game tonight.
You guys have had a lot of tough Western Conference matchups as of late. Do you find that the Western Conference style can be really tiring?
Oh, 100%. Like, they're such skilled teams, and I'm not saying taking anything away from the East, but it's like there's a ton of skilled players and a ton of skilled teams in the West, and every game's a battle. So,
with Jacob Friend out of the lineup, it means that other members of the defense have been asked to sort of take on a more important role, yourself included. You've been logging a ton of minutes as of late. How have you felt about your play?
I think I'm just trying to keep it more consistent, trying to keep my play simple and moving the puck as fast as possible, just try and create some offense for our forwards. So, yeah.
And when you look at this defense, you've been paired up with some different guys, but overall, it's the chemistry kind of run right through the lineup?
Yeah, I mean, everyone plays with everyone. It just depends on who's going that night and what the line matching is like. So, you have to be comfortable with every player, and I think we are a pretty meshed group, so you can't really complain that way. So,
you guys have a road trip coming up next weekend. First, you go to Hamilton for a day game. First of all, playing in a school day game, how do you have to change your preparation?
I've never actually played for one of those, but it'll be interesting. Apparently there's a lot of people going to it, so it'll be a packed house, so it'll be interesting.
And then next weekend you guys go on the road, the Eastern Swing, Ottawa and Kingston, back-to-back games against Eastern Conference teams, but you guys really haven't had many road trips as of late. How important will that be just for some good bonding time with the guys?
Oh, it'll be huge. Long bus ride, so it'll definitely be a lot of bonding time, talking time, doing whatever, and on the bus. But no, definitely a couple days away from home, so it'll be good.
All right, well, best of luck next weekend.
Yeah, thank you.
He's definitely happy with the way that his defensive core had played, seeing as the last couple games before that, it was a little rocky. But now, seems like they've righted the ship with that. We're going to go for another interview with Kevin Hancock.
Standing outside or inside the attack dressing room with Kevin Hancock. Kevin, a big 4-1 win tonight over the Windsor Spitfires. Coming into tonight's game, you were coming off a tough loss last night in London. How important was it to have a big bounce back effort tonight, not just to get the points in the standings, but to sort of kind of boost the momentum around the team?
Oh, for sure. You know, today was a huge game for us, and we knew that coming in, and I think we stayed to the game plan, which really helped us.
Windsor's a team that's got a fair bit of size on them, and they like to play a physical game. Seemed like emotions were pretty high in that game. You're having some words there with already at the end. Do you like when the games kind of ramp up like that with the emotion?
Oh yeah, it's exciting when that happens. A lot more stuff happens during the game. It gets you more engaged, which is awesome.
You had a really nice goal where you picked the corner there on the power play. You've been firing all season long and really been getting rewarded. Has your confidence level really risen as the year's gone on?
Well, for sure. From the start of the year, had a little tough time scoring goals, but confidence has been getting up there, and playing with some great guys, Jonah and Nick. They're great guys to play with, and I think we're moving the puck very well together.
You talk about playing with Jonah and Nick. Clearly the chemistry is through the roof with those two guys, but when you're out on the ice with them, is it just sort of a case of knowing where the other guy's going to be, or does everyone kind of have an attribute that complements each other?
Well, like what you said there, we feel like we know where each other are on the ice, and all three of us bring different things to the line, which really complements each other.
Now, coming up this week, you've got three road games, including a school day game against Hamilton. I think it's the first time the Owen Sound franchise has ever taken part in a school day game. Are you looking forward to that atmosphere?
Yeah, it's going to be awesome. It's a big building. I assume that it's going to be really full, which I think was going to be great.
And then next weekend, you guys head to Ottawa and Kingston. You've played a lot of games against Western Conference teams, and obviously there's no nights off in the Western Conference, and not knocking on the Eastern Conference, but do you look forward to kind of playing some teams that you don't see too often?
Well, yeah, it's exciting to play different players, but we know that they're great teams in the East. They come every night to battle, and obviously we just came off a 15-game winning streak, so they're obviously going to be coming after us. So, I mean, I think those will be really two great games out there.
All right, well, best of luck next week.
Thank you.
And as Kevin Hancock did say, game tomorrow with the Hamilton Bulldogs at 10:30. We're going to pull up the upcoming games for you here, and you can take a look at what the Owen Sound Attack are going to be doing for the last 9 or 10 games. Wednesday, or tomorrow I should say, they're playing in Hamilton, and then they've got their Eastern swing where they play Ottawa on Saturday, and then Sunday they're with the Kingston Frontenacs, then back home hosting Flint here on February the 15th. Then on Friday, they're in London again. They look to grab some redemption there. And then Saturday, home to Oshawa. And you see it there, February 20th, Mississauga, Kitchener, London, and then Erie. They only have 19 games left on the season, so this is definitely crunch time for these OHL teams and for the Owen Sound Attack. They want to go and be able to finish strong, 33-14-1-1 on the season for the Owen Sound Attack right now. Played only 49 games, like we talked about, 19 games left, and 3 points back of the Windsor Spitfires. That has been a dogfight for the last 4 or 5 weeks with Windsor, and they certainly have Windsor's number over the last three or four times that they've been able to play them. And for Owen Sound Attack fans, you rightfully so want to see them grab that fourth spot, but we'll have to see how it all pans out. Like we talked about, February 15th, next home game with the Flint Firebirds. Thank you very much for joining us with this one, but we're going to, I did want to tell you one quick thing. CHL Top 10, the Owen Sound Attack, number 9 on the list. You see it there. And 5 OHL teams round out the CHL Top 10. Erie Otters, London Knights, the Sault Ste. Marie Greyhounds, and the Owen Sound Attack. Windsor is an honorable mention, but the Owen Sound Attack move up to 9 from 10 last week. So for Attack fans and for anybody that follows the OHL, it should be an exciting thing to see not only 4 teams there, let alone the Owen Sound Attack be there as well. So definitely exciting for the Attack, and see if they can slowly move up that CHL Top 10 ranking while the rest of this season goes along. Thank you once again very much for tuning in with us for tonight's segment of Attack Wrap. Stick around as we'll have more Owen Sound Attack guests in studio with us next week. And John Morris will be back with us as well. Take care.